The Ancestors of Peter Atherly. By Bret Harte. Podcast 1 of 3. Chapter 1. It must be admitted that the civilizing processes of rough and ready were not marked by any of the ameliorating conditions of other improved camps. After the discovery of the famous Eureka lead, there was the usual influx of gamblers and saloon keepers, but that was accepted as a matter of course. But it was thought hard that, after a church was built and a new school erected, it should suddenly be found necessary to have doors that locked, instead of standing shamelessly open to the criticism and temptation of wayfarers, or that portable property could no longer be left out at night in the old fond reliance on universal brotherhood. The habit of borrowing was stopped with the introduction of more money into the camp, and the establishment of rates of interest. The poorer people either took what they wanted, or as indiscreetly bought on credit. There were better clothes to be seen in its one long straggling street, but those who wore them generally lacked the grim virtue of the old pioneers, and the fairer faces that were to be seen were generally rouged. There was a year or two of this kind of mutation, in which the youthful barbarism of rough and ready might have been said to struggle with adult civilized wickedness, and then the name itself disappeared. By an act of the legislature, the growing town was called Atherly, after the owner of the Eureka mine, Peter Atherly, who had given largesse to the town in its waterworks and a gin mill, as the new Atherly Hotel and its gilded bar rooms were now called. Even at the last moment, however, the new title of Atherly hung in the balance. The romantic daughter of the pastor had said that Mr. Atherly should be called Atherly of Atherly, an aristocratic title so strongly suggestive of an innovation upon democratic principles that it was not until it was discreetly suggested that everybody was still free to call him Atherly, late of Rough and Ready, that opposition ceased. Possibly this incident may have first awakened him to the value of his name, and some anxiety as to its origin. Roughly speaking, Atherly's father was only a bucolic emigrant from Missouri, and his mother had done the washing for the camp on her first arrival. The Atherlys had suffered on their overland journey from drought and famine, with the addition of being captured by Indians, who had held them captive for 10 months. Indeed, Mr. Atherly, Sr., never recovered from the effects of his captivity, and died shortly after Mrs. Atherly had given birth to twins, Peter and Jenny Atherly. This was scant knowledge for Peter in the glorification of his name through his immediate progenitors, but Atherly of Atherly still sounded pleasantly, and, as the young lady had said, smacked of old feudal days and honors. It was believed beyond doubt, even in their simple family records, the flyleaf of a Bible, that Peter Atherly's great-grandfather was an Englishman who brought over to His Majesty's Virginian possessions his only son, then a boy. It was not established, however, to what class of deportation he belonged, whether he was suffering exile from religious or judicial conviction, or if he were only one of the articled apprentices who largely made up the American immigration of those days. Howbeit, Atherly was undoubtedly an English name, even suggesting respectable and landed ancestry, and Peter Atherly was proud of it. He looked somewhat askance upon his Irish and German fellow citizens, and talked a good deal about race. Two things, however, concerned him. He was not in looks certainly like any type of modern Englishman as seen either on the stage in San Francisco, or as an actual tourist in the mining regions, and his accent was undoubtedly southwestern. He was tall and dark, with deep-set eyes in a singularly immobile countenance. He had an erect but lithe and sinewy figure even for his 30-odd years, and might easily have been taken for any other American except for the single exception that his nose was distinctly Roman, and gave him a distinguished air. There was a suggestion of Abraham Lincoln, and even of Don Quixote, in his tall, melancholy figure and length of limb, but nothing whatever that suggested an Englishman. It was shortly after the christening of Atherly Town that an incident occurred which at first shook, and then the more firmly established, his mild monomania. His widowed mother had been for the last 2 years an inmate of a private asylum for inebriates, through certain habits contracted while washing for the camp in the first year of her widowhood. This had always been a matter of open sympathy to Rough and Ready, but it was a secret reproach hinted at in Atherly, although it was known that the rich Peter Atherly kept his mother liberally supplied, and that both he and his sister Jenny or Jenny Atherly visited her frequently. One day he was telegraphed for, and on going to the asylum found Mrs. Atherly delirious and raving. Through her son's liberality she had bribed an attendant, and was fast succumbing to a private debauch. In the intervals of her delirium she called Peter by name, talked frenziedly and mysteriously of his high connections, alluded to himself and his sister as being of the true breed, and with a certain vigor of epithet, picked up in the familiarity of the camp during the days when she was known as Old Mam Atherly or Aunt Sally, declared that they were no corn-cracking Hoosiers, hayseed pikes, nor northern Yankee scum, and that she should yet live to see them holding their own lands again, and the lands of their forefathers. Quieted at last by opiates, she fell into a more lucid but scarcely less distressing attitude. Recognizing her son again, as well as her own fast failing condition, she sarcastically thanked him for coming to see her off, congratulated him that he would soon be spared the lie and expense of keeping her here on account of his pride, under the thin pretext of trying to cure her. She knew that Sally Atherly of Rough and Ready wasn't considered fit company for Atherly of Atherly by his fine new friends. This and much more in a voice mingling maudlin sentiment with bitter resentment, and with an ominous glitter in her bloodshot and glary eyes. Peter winced with the consciousness of the half-truth of her reproaches, but the curiosity and excitement awakened by the revelations of her frenzy were greater than his remorse. He said quickly, "You were speaking of father, of his family, his lands and possessions. Tell me again. What are ye giving us?" she ejaculated in husky suspicion, opening upon him her beady eyes, in which the film of death was already gathering. "Tell me of father, my father and his family, his great-grandfather, the Atherlys, my relations, what you were saying. What do you know about them? That's all ye want to know, is it? That's what ye are come into the old washerwoman for, is it?" she burst out with the desperation of disgust. "Well, give it up. Ask me another." "But, mother, the old records, you know. The family Bible, what you once told us, me and Jinny." Something gurgled in her throat like a chuckle. With the energy of malevolence, she stammered, "There wasn't no records, there wasn't no family Bible, it's all a lie, you hear me. Your Atherly that you're so proud of was just a British bummer who was kicked out of his family in England and sent to buzz round in Amerika. He honeyfogled me Sally MacGregor out of a better family than his in Kansas, and skugled me away, but it was a straight-out marriage, and I can prove it. It was in the St. Louis papers, and I've got it stored away safe enough in my trunk. You hear me? I'm shouting. But he wasn't no old settler in Missouri, he wasn't descended from any settler, either. He was a new man outer England, fresh caught and talked down his throat. And he fooled me, the darter of an old family that was settled on the right bank of the Missouri afore Daniel Boone came to Kentucky with his new philanderings. Then he broke up, and went all to pieces when we struck California, and left me Sally MacGregor, whose father had racial expletives of his own to wash for Rough and Ready. That's your Atherly. Take him. I don't want him, I've done with him. I was done with him long afore a cough checked her utterance afore she gasped again, but the words seemed to strangle in her throat. Intent only on her words and scarcely heeding her sufferings, Peter was bending over her eagerly, when the doctor rudely pulled him away and lifted her to a sitting posture. But she never spoke again. The strongest restoratives quickly administered only left her in a state of scarcely breathing unconsciousness. "Is she dying? Can't you bring her to," said the anxious Peter, "if only for a moment, doctor?" "I'm thinking," said the visiting doctor, an old Scotch army surgeon, looking at the rich Mr. Atherly with cool, professional contempt, "that your mother willna do any more washing for me as in the old time, nor give up her life again to support her bairns. And it isna my intention to bring her back to pain for the purposes of general conversation. Nor, indeed, did she ever come back to any purpose, but passed away with her unfinished sentence. And her limbs were scarcely decently composed by the attendants before Peter was rummaging the trunk in her room for the paper she had spoken of. It was in an old workbox, a now faded yellow clipping from a newspaper, lying amidst spoils of cotton thread, buttons, and beeswax, which he even then remembered to have seen upon his mother's lap when she soup-rad the sewing on of buttons to her washing of the miners' shirts. And his dark and hollow cheek glowed with gratified sentiment as he read the clipping. "We hear with regret of the death of Philip Atherly, Esquire, of Rough and Ready, California. Mr. Atherly will be remembered by some of our readers as the hero of the romantic elopement of Miss Sally MacGregor, daughter of Colonel Bob MacGregor, which created such a stir in well-to-do circles some 30 years ago. It was known vaguely that the young couple had gone west, a then unknown region, but it seems that after severe trials and tribulations on the frontier with savages, they emigrated early to Oregon, and then, on the outbreak of the gold fever, to California. But it will be a surprise to many to know that it has just transpired that Mr. Atherly was the second son of Sir Ashley Atherly, an English baronet, and by the death of his brother might have succeeded to the property and title." He remained for some moments looking fixedly at the paper, until the commonplace paragraph imprinted itself upon his brain as no line of sage or poet had ever done, and then he folded it up and put it in his pocket. In his exaltation he felt that even the mother he had never loved was promoted to a certain respect as his father's wife, although he was equally conscious of a new resentment against her for her contemptuous allusions to his father, and her evident hopeless inability to comprehend his position. His mother, he feared, was indeed low, but he was his father's son. Nevertheless, he gave her a funeral at Atherly, long remembered for its barbaric opulence and display. 30 carriages, procured from Sacramento at great expense, were freely offered to his friends to join in the astounding pageant. A wonderful casket of iron and silver, brought from San Francisco, held the remains of the ex-washerwoman of Rough and Ready. But a more remarkable innovation was the addition of a royal crown to the other ornamentation of the casket. Peter Atherly's ideas of heraldry were very vague. Sacramento at that time offered him no opportunity of knowing what were the arms of the Atherlys, and the introduction of the royal crown seemed to satisfy Peter's mind as to what a crest might be, while to the ordinary democratic mind it simply suggested that the corpse was English. Political criticism being thus happily averted, Mrs. Atherly's body was laid in the little cemetery, not far away from certain rude wooden crosses which marked the burial place of wanderers whose very names were unknown, and in due time a marble shaft was erected over it. But when, the next day, the county paper contained, in addition to the column and a half description of the funeral, the more formal announcement of the death of Mrs. Sally Atherly, wife of the late Philip Atherly, second son of Sir Ashley Atherly, of England, criticism and comment broke out. The old pioneers of Rough and Ready felt that they had been imposed upon, and that in some vague way the unfortunate woman had made them the victims of a huge practical joke during all these years. That she had grimly enjoyed their ignorance of her position they did not doubt. "Why, I remember unked when I was sorter bullyraggin' her about mixin' up my duds with Doc Simmons, and sendin' me Whiskey Dick's old rags, she turned round sudden with a kind of screech, and ran out into the brush. I reckoned, at the time, that it was either drink or feelance, and could HEV kicked myself for being sassy to the old woman, but I know now that all this time that air critter that baronet's daughter-in-law was just Logan herself into fits in the brush. No, sir, she played this year camp for all it was worth, year in and out, and we just gave ourselves away like speckled idiots. And now she's lying out there in the boneyard, and keeps on peeing tin the joke, and a roaring at us in marble." Even the later citizens in Atherly felt an equal resentment against her, but from different motives. That her drinking habits and her powerful vocabulary were all the effect of her aristocratic alliance they never doubted. And, although it brought the virtues of their own superior republican sobriety into greater contrast, they felt a scandal at having been tricked into attending this gilded funeral of dissipated rank. Peter Atherly found himself unpopular in his own town. The sober who drank from his free waterworks, and the giddy ones who imbibed at his gin mill, equally criticized him. He could not understand it. His peculiar predilections had been accepted before, when they were mere presumptions, why should they not now, when they were admitted facts? He was conscious of no change in himself since the funeral. yet the criticism went on. Presently it took the milder but more contagious form of ridicule. In his own hotel, built with his own money, and in his own presence, he had heard a reckless frequenter of the bar room decline some proffered refreshment on the ground that he only drank with his titled relatives. A local humorist, amidst the applause of an admiring crowd at the post office window, had openly accused the postmaster of withholding letters to him from his only surviving brother, the Duke of Dunkerque. "The old Dookie never unk missed the mail to let me know what's going on in me childhood's home," remarked the humorist plaintively, "and yours this dod blasted government mule of a postmaster keeping me letters back. Letters with pretentious and gilded coats of arms, taken from the decorated inner lining of cigar boxes, were posted to prominent citizens. The neighboring and unregenerate settlement of Red Dog was more outrageous in its contribution. The Red Dog Sentinel, in commenting on the death of Hallbowlin Tom, a drunken English man-o'-war's man, said, 'It may not be generally known that our regretted fellow citizen, while serving on HMS Boxer, was secretly married to Queen Kakalu of the Friendly Group, but, unlike some of our prosperous neighbors, he never boasted of his royal alliance, and resisted with steady British pluck any invitation to share the throne. Indeed, any allusion to the subject affected him deeply. There are those among us who will remember the beautiful portrait of his royal bride tattooed upon his left arm with the royal crest and the crossed flags of the two nations.' Only Peter Atherly and his sister understood the sting inflicted either by accident or design in the latter sentence. Both he and his sister had some singular hieroglyphic branded on their arms, probably a reminiscence of their life on the plains in their infant Indian captivity. But there was no mistaking the general sentiment. The criticisms of a small town may become ineffaceable. Atherly determined to take the first opportunity to leave rough and ready. He was rich, his property was secure, there was no reason why he should stay where his family pretensions were a drawback. And a further circumstance determined his resolution. He was awaiting his sister in his new house on a little crest above the town. She had been at the time of her mother's death, and since, a private boarder in the Sacred Heart Convent at Santa Clara, whence she had been summoned to the funeral, but had returned the next day. Few people had noticed in her brother's carriage the veiled figure which might have belonged to one of the religious orders, still less did they remember the dark, lank, heavy-browed girl who had sometimes been seen about rough and ready. For she had her brother's melancholy, and greater reticence, and had continued of her own free will, long after her girlish pupilage at the convent, to live secluded under its maternal roof without taking orders. A general suspicion that she was either a religious crank, or considered herself too good to live in a mountain mining town, had not contributed to her brother's popularity. In her abstraction from worldly ambitions, she had, naturally, taken no part in her brother's family pretensions. He had given her an independent allowance, and she was supposed to be equally a sharer in his good fortune. Yet she had suddenly declared her intention of returning to Atherly, to consult him on affairs of importance. Peter was both surprised and eager. There was but little affection between them, but, preoccupied with his one idea, he was satisfied that she wanted to talk about the family. But he was amazed, disappointed, and disconcerted. For Jenny Atherly, the sober recluse of Santa Clara, hidden in her somber draperies at the funeral, was no longer to be recognized in the fashionable, smartly but somewhat overdressed woman he saw before him. In spite of her large features and the distinguishing Roman nose, like his own, she looked even pretty in her excitement. She had left the convent, she was tired of the life there, she was satisfied that a religious vocation would not suit her. In brief, she intended to enjoy herself like other women. If he really felt a pride in the family, he ought to take her out, like other brothers, and give her a show. He could do it there if he liked, and she would keep house for him. If he didn't want to, she must have enough money to keep her fashionably in San Francisco. But she wanted excitement, and that she would have. She wanted to go to balls, theaters, and entertainments, and she intended to. Her voice grew quite high, and her dark cheek glowed with some newfound emotion. Astounded as he was, Peter succumbed. It was better that she should indulge her astounding caprice under his roof than elsewhere. It would not do for the sister of an Atherly to provoke scandal. He gave entertainments, picnics, and parties, and Jenny Atherly plunged into these mild festivities with the enthusiasm of a schoolgirl. She not only could dance with feverish energy all night, but next day could mount a horse. She was a fearless rider and lead the most accomplished horseman. She was a good shot, she walked with the untiring foot of a coyote, she threaded the woods with the instinct of a pioneer. Peter regarded her with a singular mingling of astonishment and fear. Surely she had not learned this at school. These were not the teachings nor the sports of the good sisters. He once dared to interrogate her regarding this change in her habits. "I always felt like it," she answered quickly, "but I kept it down. I used sometimes to feel that I couldn't stand it any longer, but must rush out and do something," she said passionately, "but," she went on with furtive eyes, and a sudden wild timidity like that of a fawn, "I was afraid. I was afraid it was like mother. It seemed to me to be her blood that was rising in me, and I kept it down. I didn't want to be like her, and I prayed and struggled against it." "Did you," she said, suddenly grasping his hand, "ever feel like that?" But Peter never had. His melancholy faith in his father's race had left no thought of his mother's blood mingling with it. "But," he said gravely, believing this, "why did you change?" "Because I could hold out no longer. I should have gone crazy. Times I wanted to take some of those meek nuns, some of those white-faced pupils with their blue eyes and wavy flaxen hair, and strangle them. I couldn't strive and pray and struggle any longer there, and so I came here to let myself out. I suppose when I get married, and I ought to, with my money, it may change me." "You don't suppose," she said, with a return of her wild animal-like timidity, "it is anything that was in father, in those Atherlies, do you?" But Peter had no idea of anything but virtue in the Atherly blood. He had heard that the upper class of Europeans were fond of field sports and of hunting. It was odd that his sister should inherit this propensity and not he. He regarded her more kindly for this evidence of race. "You think of getting married," he said more gently, yet with a certain brotherly doubt that any man could like her enough, even with her money. "Is there anyone here would suit you?" he added diplomatically. "No, I hate them all," she burst out. "There isn't one I don't despise for his sickening, foppish, womanish airs." Nevertheless, it was quite evident that some of the men were attracted by her singular originality and a certain good comradeship in her ways. And it was on one of their riding excursions that Peter noticed that she was singled out by a good-looking, blonde-haired young lawyer of the town for his especial attentions. As the cavalcade straggled in climbing the mountain, the young fellow rode close to her saddlebow, and as the distance lengthened between the other stragglers, they at last were quite alone. When the trail became more densely wooded, Peter quite lost sight of them. But when, a few moments later, having lost the trail himself, they again appeared in the distance before him, he was so amazed that he unconsciously halted. For the two horses were walking side by side, and the stranger's arm was round his sister's waist. Had Peter any sense of humor, he might have smiled at this weakness in his Amazonian sister, but he saw only the serious, practical side of the situation, with, of course, its inevitable relation to his one controlling idea. The young man was in good practice, and would have made an eligible husband to anyone else. But was he fit to mate with an Atherly? What would those as yet unknown and powerful relatives say to it? At the same time, he could not help knowing that Jenny, in the eccentricities of her virgin spinsterhood, might be equally objectionable to them, as she certainly was a severe trial to him here. If she were off his hands, he might be able to prosecute his search for his relatives with more freedom. After all, there were mésalliances in all families, and being a woman, she was not in the direct line. Instead, therefore, of spurring forward to join them, he lingered a little until they passed out of sight, and until he was joined by a companion from behind. Him, too, he purposely delayed. They were walking slowly, breathing their mustangs, when his companion suddenly uttered a cry of alarm, and sprang from his horse. For on the trail before them lay the young lawyer quite unconscious, with his riderless steed nipping the young leaves of the underbrush. He was evidently stunned by a fall, although across his face was a livid welt which might have been caused by collision with the small elastic limb of a sapling, or a blow from a riding whip. Happily the last idea was only in Peter's mind. As they lifted him up he came slowly to consciousness. He was bewildered and dazed at first, but as he began to speak the color came back freshly to his face. He could not conceive, he stammered, what had happened. He was riding with Miss Atherly, and he supposed his horse had slipped upon some withered pine needles and thrown him. A spasm of pain crossed his face suddenly, and he lifted his hand to the top of his head. Was he hurt there? No, but perhaps his hair, which was flowing and curly, had caught in the branches like Absalom's. He tried to smile, and even begged them to assist him to his horse that he might follow his fair companion, who would be wondering where he was, but Peter, satisfied that he had received no serious injury, hurriedly enjoined him to stay, while he himself would follow his sister. Putting spurs to his horse, he succeeded, in spite of the slippery trail, in overtaking her near the summit. At the sound of his horse's hoofs she wheeled quickly, came dashing furiously towards him, and only pulled up at the sound of his voice. But she had not time to change her first attitude and expression, which was something which perplexed and alarmed him. Her long lithe figure was half crouching, half clinging to the horse's back, her loosened hair flying over her shoulders, her dark eyes gleaming with an odd nymph-like mischief. Her white teeth flashed as she recognized him, but her laugh was still mocking and uncanny. He took refuge in indignation. "What has happened?" he said sharply. "The fool tried to kiss me," she said simply. "And I let out at him like mother." Nevertheless, she gave him one of those shy, timid glances he had noticed before, and began coiling something around her fingers, with a suggestion of coy embarrassment, indescribably inconsistent with her previous masculine independence. "You might have killed him," said Peter angrily. "Perhaps I might? Ought I have killed him, Peter?" she said anxiously, yet with the same winning, timid smile. If she had not been his sister, he would have thought her quite handsome. "As it is," he said impetuously, "you have made a frightful scandal here." "He won't say anything about it, will he?" she inquired shyly, still twisting the something around her finger. Peter did not reply. Perhaps the young lawyer really loved her and would keep her secret. But he was vexed, and there was something maniacal in her twisting fingers. "What have you got there?" he said sharply. She shook the object in the air before her with a laugh. "Only a lock of his hair," she said gaily, "but I didn't cut it off." "Throw it away, and come here," he said angrily. But she only tucked the little blonde curl into her waist belt and shook her head. He urged his horse forward, but she turned and fled, laughing as he pursued her. Being the better rider, she could easily evade him whenever he got too near, and in this way they eventually reached the town and their house long before their companions. But she was far enough ahead of her brother to be able to dismount and hide her trophy with childish glee before he arrived. She was right in believing that her unfortunate cavalier would make no revelation of her conduct, and his catastrophe passed as an accident. But Peter could not disguise the fact that much of his unpopularity was shared by his sister. The matrons of Atherly believed that she was fast, and remembered more distinctly than ever the evil habits of her mother. That she would, in the due course of time, take to drink, they never doubted. Her dancing was considered outrageous in its unfettered freedom, and her extraordinary powers of endurance were looked upon as masculine by the weaker girls whose partners she took from them. She reciprocally looked down upon them, and made no secret of her contempt for their small refinements and fancies. She affected only the society of men, and even treated them with a familiarity that was both fearless and scornful. Peter saw that it was useless to face the opposition. Miss Atherly did not seem to encourage the renewal of the young lawyer's attentions, although it was evident that he was still attracted by her, nor did she seem to invite advances from others. he must go away and he would have to take her with him. It seemed ridiculous that a woman of 30, of masculine character, should require a chaperone in a brother of equal age, but Peter knew the singular blending of childlike ignorance with this Amazonian quality. He had made his arrangements for an absence from Atherly of 3 or 4 years, and they departed together. The young fair-haired lawyer came to the stagecoach office to see them off. Peter could detect no sentiment in his sister's familiar farewell of her unfortunate suitor. At New York, however, it was arranged that Jenny should stay with some friends whom they had made en route, and that, if she wished, she could come to Europe later, and join him in London. Thus relieved of one, Peter Atherly of Atherly started on his cherished quest of his other and more remote relations. Chapter 2. Peter Atherly had been 4 months in England, but knew little of the country until one summer afternoon when his carriage rolled along the well-ordered road between Noningsby Station and Ashley Grange. In that 4 months he had consulted authorities, examined records, visited the Herald's College, written letters, and made a few friends. A rich American, tracing his genealogical tree, was not a new thing even in that day in London, but there was something original and simple in his methods, and so much that was grave, reserved, and un-American in his personality, that it awakened interest. A recognition that he was a foreigner, but a puzzled doubt, however, of his exact nationality, which he found everywhere, at first pained him, but he became reconciled to it at about the same time that his English acquaintances abandoned their own reserve and caution before the greater reticence of this melancholy American, and actually became the questioners. In this way his quest became known only as a disclosure of his own courtesy, and offers of assistance were pressed eagerly upon him. That was why Sir Edward Atherly found himself gravely puzzled, as he sat with his family solicitor one morning in the library of Ashley Grange. "Humph," said Sir Edward. "And you say he has absolutely no other purpose in making these inquiries?" "Positively none," returned the solicitor. "He is even willing to sign a renunciation of any claim which might arise out of this information. It is rather a singular case, but he seems to be a rich man and quite able to indulge his harmless caprices." "And you are quite sure he is Philip's son?" "Quite, from the papers he brings me. Of course I informed him that even if he should be able to establish a legal marriage he could expect nothing as next of kin, as you had children of your own. He seemed to know that already, and avowed that his only wish was to satisfy his own mind. I suppose he wants to claim kinship and all that sort of thing for society's sake." "I do not think so," said the solicitor dryly. "I suggested an interview with you, but he seemed to think it quite unnecessary, if I could give him the information he required." "Ha," said Sir Edward promptly, "we'll invite him here. Lady Atherly can bring in some people to see him. Is he ahem, what is he like?" "The usual American, I suppose." "Not at all. Quite foreign-looking, dark, and rather like an Italian. There is no resemblance to Mr. Philip," he said, glancing at the painting of a flaxen-haired child fondling a greyhound under the elms of Ashley Park. "Ah, yes, yes. Perhaps the mother was one of those southern creoles, or mulattoes," said Sir Edward with an Englishman's tolerant regard for the vagaries of people who were clearly not English. "They're rather attractive women, I hear." "I think you do quite well to be civil to him," said the solicitor. "He seems to take an interest in the family, and being rich, and apparently only anxious to enhance the family prestige, you ought to know him. Now, in reference to those mortgages on Appleby Farm, if you could get—" "Yes, yes," said Sir Edward quickly, "we'll have him down here, and, I say, you'll come too." The solicitor bowed. "And, by the way," continued Sir Edward, "there was a girl too, wasn't there? He has a sister, I believe." "Yes, but he has left her in America." "Ah, yes, very good, yes, of course. We'll have Lord Grey's Hot and Sir Roger and old Lady Everton. She knows all about Sir Ashley and the family. And is he young or old?" "About 30, I should say, Sir Edward." "Ah, well, We'll have Lady Elfrida over from the Towers. Had Peter known of these preparations, he might have turned back to Noningsby without even visiting the old church in Ashley Park, which he had been told held the ashes of his ancestors. For during these 4 months the conviction that he was a foreigner and that he had little or nothing in common with things here had been clearly forced upon him. He could recognize some kinship in the manners and customs of the people to those he had known in the West and on the Atlantic coast, but not to his own individuality, and he seemed even more a stranger here where he had expected to feel the thrill of consanguinity than in the West. He had accepted the invitation of the living Atherly for the sake of the Atherlys long dead and forgotten. As the great quadrangle of stone and ivy lifted itself out of the park, he looked longingly towards the little square tower which peeped from between the yews nearer the road. As the carriage drove up to the carved archway whence so many Atherlys had issued into the world, he could not believe that any of his blood had gone forth from it, or, except himself, had ever entered it before. Once in the great house he felt like a prisoner as he wandered through the long corridors to his room. Even the noble trees beyond his mullioned window seemed of another growth than those he had known. There was no doubt that he created a sensation at Ashley Grange, not only from his singular kinship, but from his striking individuality. The Atherlys and their guests were fascinated and freely admiring. His very originality, which prevented them from comparing him with any English or American standard of excellence, gave them a comfortable assurance of safety in their admiration. His reserve, his seriousness, his simplicity, very unlike their own, and yet near enough to suggest a delicate flattery, was in his favor. So was his naive frankness in regard to his status in the family, shown in the few words of greeting with Sir Ashley, and in his later simple yet free admissions regarding his obscure youth, his former poverty, and his present wealth. He boasted of neither, he was disturbed by neither. Standing alone, a stranger, for the first time in an assemblage of distinguished and titled men and women, he betrayed no consciousness, surrounded for the first time by objects which he knew his wealth could not buy, he showed the most unmistakable indifference, the indifference of temperament. The ladies vied with each other to attack this unimpressible nature, this profound isolation from external attraction. They followed him about, they looked into his dark, melancholy eyes. It was impossible, they thought, that he could continue this superb acting forever. A glance, a smile, a burst of ingenuous confidence, a covert appeal to his chivalry would yet catch him tripping. But the melancholy eyes that had gazed at the treasures of Ashley Grange and the opulent ease of its guests without kindling, opened to their first emotion wonder. At which Lady Elfrida, who had ingenuously admired him, hated him a little, as the first step towards a kindlier feeling. The next day, having declared his intention of visiting Ashley Church, and, as frankly, his intention of going there alone, he slipped out in the afternoon and made his way quietly through the park to the square ivied tower he had first seen. In this tranquil level length of the wood there was the one spot, the churchyard, where, oddly enough, the green earth heaved into little billows as if to show the turbulence of that life which those who lay below them had lately quitted. It was a relief to the somewhat studied and formal monotony of the well-ordered woodland, every rood of which had been paced by visitors, keepers, or poachers, to find those decrepit and bending tombstones, lurching at every angle, or deeply sinking into the green sea of forgetfulness around them. All this, and the trodden paths of the villagers towards that common place of meeting, struck him as being more human than anything he had left behind him at the Grange. He entered the ivy-grown porch and stared for a moment at the half-legal official parochial notices posted on the oaken door, his first obtrusive intimation of the combination of church and state, and hesitated. He was not prepared to find that this last resting place of his people had something to do with taxes and tithes, and that a certain material respectability and security attended his votive sigh. God and the reigning sovereign of the realm preserved a decorous alliance in the royal arms that appeared above the official notices. Presently he pushed open the door gently and entered the nave. For a moment it seemed to him as if the arched gloom of the woods he had left behind was repeated in the dim aisle and vaulted roof. There was an earthy odor, as if the church itself, springing from the fertilizing dust below, had taken root in the soil, The checkers of light from the faded stained glass windows fell like the flicker of leaves on the pavement. He paused before the cold altar, and started, for beside him lay the recumbent figure of a warrior pillowed on his helmet with the paraphernalia of his trade around him. A sudden childish memory of the great western plains, and the biers of the Indian braves raised on upright poles against the staring sky and above the sun-baked prairie, rushed upon him. There, too, had lain the weapons of the departed chieftain, there, too, lay the Indian's faithful hound, here simulated by the cross-legged crusader's canine effigy. And now, strangest of all, he found that this unlooked-for recollection and remembrance thrilled him more at that moment than the dead before him. Here they rested, the Atherlys of centuries, recumbent in armor or priestly robes, upright in busts that were periwigged or hidden in long curls, above the marble record of their deeds and virtues. Some of these records were in Latin, an unknown tongue to Peter, some in a quaint English almost as unintelligible, but none as foreign to him as the dead themselves. Their banners waved above his head, their voices filled the silent church, but fell upon his vacant eye and duller ear. He was none of them. Presently he was conscious of a footstep, so faint, so subtle, that it might have come from a peregrinating ghost. He turned quickly and saw Lady Elfrida, half bold, yet half frightened, halting beside a pillar of the chancel. But there was nothing of the dead about her, she was radiating and pulsating with the uncompromising and material freshness of English girlhood. The wild rose in the hedgerow was not more tangible than her cheek, nor the summer sky more clearly cool and blue than her eyes. The vigor of health and unfettered freedom of limb was in her figure, from her buckled walking shoe to her brown hair topped by a sailor hat. The assurance and contentment of a well-ordered life, of secured position and freedom from vain anxieties or expectations, were visible in every line of her refined, delicate, and evenly quiescent features. And yet Lady Elfrida, for the first time in her girlhood, felt a little nervous. Yet she was frank, too, with the frankness of those who have no thought of being misunderstood. She said she had come there out of curiosity to see how he would get on with his ancestors. She had been watching him from the chancel ever since he came, and she was disappointed. As far as emotion went, she thought he had the advantage of the stoniest and longest dead of them all. Perhaps he did not like them. But he must be careful what he said, for some of her own people were there, manifestly this one. She put the toe of her buckled shoe on the crusader Peter had just looked at. And then there was another in the corner. So she had a right to come there as well as he, and she could act as cicerone. This one was a de Bressy, one of King John's knights, who married an Atherly. She swung herself into a half-sitting posture on the effigy of the dead knight, composed her straight short skirt over her trim ankles, and looked up in Peter's dark face. That would make them some kind of relations, wouldn't it? He must come over to Bentley Towers and see the rest of the de Bressy in the chapel there tomorrow. Perhaps there might be some he liked better, and who looked more like him. For there was no one here or at the Grange who resembled him in the least. He assented to the truth of this with such grave, disarming courtesy, and yet with such undisguised wonder, as she appeared to talk with greater freedom to a stranger than an American girl would, that she at once popped off the crusader, and accompanied him somewhat more demurely around the church. Suddenly she stopped with a slight exclamation. They had halted before a tablet to the memory of a later Atherly, an officer of His Majesty's 100th Foot, who was killed at Braddock's defeat. The tablet was supported on the one side by a weeping Fame, and on the other by a manacled North American Indian. She stammered and said, "You see, there are other Atherlys who went to America even before your father," and then stopped with a sense of having made a slip. A wild and inexplicable resentment against this complacent historical outrage suddenly took possession of Peter. He knew that his rage was inconsistent with his usual calm, but he could not help it. His swarthy cheek glowed, his dark eyes flashed, he almost trembled with excitement as he hurriedly pointed out to Lady Elfrida that the Indians were victorious in that ill-fated expedition of the British forces, and that the captive savage was an allegorical lie. So swift and convincing was his emotion that the young girl, knowing nothing of the subject and caring less, shared his indignation, followed him with anxious eyes, and their hands for an instant touched in innocent and generous sympathy. And then he knew not how or why a still more wild and terrible idea sprang up in his fancy. He knew it was madness, yet for a moment he could only stand and grapple with it silently and breathlessly. It was to seize this young and innocent girl, this witness of his disappointment, this complacent and beautiful type of all they valued here, and bear her away a prisoner, a hostage he knew not why on a galloping horse in the dust of the prairie far beyond the seas. It was only when he saw her cheek flush and pale, when he saw her staring at him with helpless, frightened, but fascinated eyes, the eyes of the fluttering bird under the spell of the rattlesnake, that he drew his breath and turned bewildered away. "And do you know, dear," she said with naive simplicity to her sister that evening, "that although he was an American, and everybody says that they don't care at all for those poor Indians, he was so magnanimous in his indignation that I fancied he looked like one of Cooper's heroes himself rather than an Atherly. It was such a stupid thing for me to show him that tomb of Major Atherly, you know, who fought the Americans, didn't he, or was it later, but I quite forgot he was an American." And with this belief in her mind, and in the high expiation of a noble nature, she forbore her characteristic raillery, and followed him meekly, manacled in spirit like the allegorical figure, to the church porch, where they separated, to meet on the morrow. But that morrow never came. For late in the afternoon a cable message reached him from California asking him to return to accept a nomination to Congress from his own district. It determined his resolution, which for a moment at the church porch had wavered under the bright eyes of Lady Elfrida. He telegraphed his acceptance, hurriedly took leave of his honestly lamenting kinsman, followed his dispatch to London, and in a few days was on the Atlantic. How he was received in California, how he found his sister married to the blonde lawyer, how he recovered his popularity and won his election, are details that do not belong to this chronicle of his quest. And that quest seems to have terminated forever with his appearance at Washington to take his seat as congressman. It was the night of a levee at the White House. The East Room was crowded with smartly dressed men and women of the Capitol, quaintly simple legislators from remote states in bygone fashions, officers in uniform, and the diplomatic circle blazing with orders. The invoker of this brilliant assembly stood in simple evening dress near the door, unattended and hedged by no formality. He shook the hand of the new congressman heartily, congratulated him by name, and turned smilingly to the next comer. Presently there was a slight stir at one of the opposite doors, the crowd fell back, and five figures stalked majestically into the center of the room. They were the leading chiefs of an Indian reservation coming to pay their respects to their great father, the president. Their costumes were a mingling of the picturesque with the grotesque, of tawdriness with magnificence, of artificial tinsel and glitter with the regal spoils of the chase, of childlike vanity with barbaric pride. Yet before these the glittering orders and ribbons of the diplomats became dull and meaningless, the uniforms of the officers mere servile livery. Their painted, immobile faces and plumed heads towered with grave dignity above the meaner crowd, their inscrutable eyes returned no response to the timid glances directed towards them. They stood by themselves, alone and impassive, yet their presence filled the room with the sense of kings. The unostentatious, simple Republican court suddenly seemed to have become royal. Even the interpreter who stood between their remote dignity and the nearer civilized world acquired the status of a court chamberlain. When their great father, apparently the less important personage, had smilingly received them, a political colleague approached Peter and took his arm. "Gray Eagle would like to speak with you. Come on. Here's your chance. You may be put on the Committee on Indian Relations, and pick up a few facts. Remember, we want a firm policy, no more palaver about the Great Father and no more blankets and guns. You know what we used to say out west, the only good Indian is a dead one. So wait in, and hear what the old plug hat has to say." Peter permitted himself to be led to the group. Even at that moment he remembered the figure of the Indian on the tomb at Ashley Grange, and felt a slight flash of satisfaction over the superior height and bearing of Grey Eagle. "How," said Grey Eagle. "How," said the other four chiefs. "How," repeated Peter instinctively. At a gesture from Grey Eagle, the interpreter said, "Let your friend stand back, Grey Eagle has nothing to say to him. He wishes to speak only with you." Peter's friend reluctantly withdrew, but threw a cautioning glance towards him.
"Ugh," said Grey Eagle.
"Ugh," said the other chiefs.
A few guttural words followed to the interpreter, who turned, and facing Peter with the monotonous impassiveness which he had caught from the chiefs, said, "He says he knew your father. He was a great chief with many horses and many squaws. He is dead."
"My father was an Englishman, Philip Atherly," said Peter, with an odd nervousness creeping over him.
The interpreter repeated the words to Grey Eagle, who, after a guttural ugh, answered in his own tongue. "He says," continued the interpreter with a slight shrug, yet relapsing into his former impassiveness, "that your father was a great chief, and your mother a pale face, or white woman. She was captured with an Englishman, but she became the wife of the chief while in captivity. She was only released before the birth of her children, but a year or two afterwards she brought them as infants to see their father the great chief and to get the mark of their tribe. He says you and your sister are each marked on the left arm." Then Grey Eagle opened his mouth and uttered his first English sentence. "His father, big Injin, take common white squaw. Papoose no good, too much white squaw mother, not enough big Injin father. Look. He big man, but no can bear pain.
Ugh."
The interpreter turned in time to catch Peter. He had fainted.